Assalamu alaikum, greetings, and welcome to the Munir Muhammad Show. I'm your host, Jamil Muhammad, and we are streaming live. If you'd like to participate in today's conversation, you can give us a call at 773-434-6625. I have a very exciting guest for us today, brothers and sisters, but before I introduce her, I want to remind you, as always, to please follow us on our social media platforms, which include Facebook and Twitter, and go to our YouTube page, click the like and subscribe buttons so you can be notified whenever we post a show. I'm very excited to be joined in studio by the Global Director of Programs and Operations for the Harold Washington Cultural Center, my friend and sister, Jemalita Tillman. How are you, sister?
Wonderful. Thank you for having me. It's great to be here. It's feeling like, just feel like I'm at home.
You are at home. This is home. You know, I'm always excited when you come on because I know that you have a wealth of information to share with the community, not only about things that are forthcoming, but things that are going on actually right now. Mm-hmm. I know you're out in the field doing things today before you came here.
Yeah.
So you're very busy. But for those who may not be familiar with you, why don't you take a few moments just to introduce yourself to our audience?
Okay, well, I'm Jemalita Tillman, Global Director of Programs and Operations at the Harold Washington Cultural Center. We're located at 4701 South King Drive in the heart of Chicago's historic Blues District in Bronzeville. And we are the lead premier community-based theater in the country, not just black-owned, but like the lead and premier, because we take it from the page to the stage when we're working with young people as well as adults. At the Harold Washington Cultural Center, we have a 1,000-seat theater, a recording studio, a video editing lab, a new podcast lab, multiple dance studios, and multi-purpose rooms. And so we're there and very active for the community. Recently, we had our Winter Wonder Fest, which brought together business owners and performers and talent. And we were able to do a major give back to the community this past week. But we have so much to catch up on with what we've done all this year, returning back to what the new normal looks like.
Yes, you know, and I know that I can't have the show without acknowledging your dear mother, pioneer.
Absolutely.
Alderman Dorothy Tillman.
Mm-hmm.
And I know if she's watching, you know, but I know everyone really wants to know about your daughter. So what's the latest going on with her?
Okay, well, here's the great thing. They're out running around together right now.
Okay.
I'm in between two bookends of the Dorothys. And for those who don't know, the name Dorothy means a gift from God. So what a blessing I've got between the two of them.
Yes.
One of the things that's really cool of the tight relationship between my mother and my daughter is that my mom was a prodigy in her own right. So at 14 years old, she's running around with Dr. King.
Yes.
At 14, 15, my daughter's working on her doctorate in behavioral health. So it's like my mother was getting her doctorate in political science, right? And social as a social scientist and just a civil rights scientist. And now my daughter's carrying that legacy on. So being stuck between two prodigies has its blessings. And then it has its times where it's like, y'all can just have each other and go continue to finish each other's sentences. Mm-hmm. But Dorothy Jean, you know, she got her associate's at 10 in psychology. Mm-hmm. She uses that degree exceptionally well. She has a bachelor's that she got at 12 years old. She completed her master's at 14, making her the world's youngest environmental scientist. And her degrees were environmental and sustainable science. And just when I thought we were going to pump the brakes, I was going to get a little time off from all of the academia side of her life, she decided she wanted to press forward and pursue her PhD. And so she got accepted to a lot of the top schools because everybody wanted her. She's currently enrolled at Arizona State University.
All right.
And she is working toward her doctorate in integrated behavioral health. So it's a DBH. So what that means is it's a cross between where physical and mental health meet, because sometimes you don't think about how, if your mind's not together, how it can affect chronic illnesses within your body. She takes a holistic approach to it, which is a very non-traditional to present in terms, especially with her thesis and what she's working on, because she understands that there are things going on within our community, with her peer, within her peer group, that deal with things such as substance use disorder, right? Pill sharing, breaking into grandma's pill cabinet, or even insomnia disorder, where a lot of young people are staying outside hanging out late because they don't have the proper sleep pattern. And that's often due to what she taught me is called ACE, adverse childhood effects. So experiences that happen within someone's childhood, then as they're going into adolescence and then further on into their adult life, you're seeing these things wane, and then it rears its head as substance use disorder. And then next thing you know, they're getting diagnosed with cancer, and then it's diabetes, and then it's all these other things, but it's all tied together. And that's why it is important to fuel your body and your mind with live foods, right? And that's why Eating to Live is so important. And her foundation comes from Muhammad University of Islam. And she carries a lot of those principles into where she is right now. And I'm so proud of her. At 15 years old, she is everything of a 15-year-old from the south side of Chicago, from 43rd and King Drive. She likes the same things that other 15-year-olds like, but she's able to, when she enters the room, she brings another moral compass amongst her peers. And so as a peer leader, I'm really proud of her and the direction she takes a lot of. And that doesn't necessarily isolate her where she's not able to go and do. It's like she comes in the room and her friends, they straighten up and they do the right thing. And that's what I really appreciate. They bring out the best of who they are. She brings out the best of who they are and themselves.
That's wonderful. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we could have the whole show about her, but we're going to talk about some other things. Mm-hmm. And I want to talk about the Hero Watch the Culture.
Okay.
Just because I know that Bronzeville, there's been a resurgence in Bronzeville, but talk about the importance of the Harold Washington Cultural Center. I know that I've attended several events there, and you always have an open door to the community as well. So just talk about, because everyone doesn't live in Bronzeville,
that's right.
You know, and you know, we want our people to understand what a jewel we have over there.
Wonderful. So during the shutdown, if you will, we became home to a lot of performing arts groups and organizations to be able to produce their shows from within our facility virtually. The same thing with teachers and educators. We also became a safe learning space of enrichment, expanding our programming with students that are in public schools, private schools, and those that are even homeschooled to be able to go that extra step, because it got a little tough for everybody being at school, not everybody at home during the school time. And so we utilized the time that everybody was scrambling because the sky was falling. We were harvesting what we had been planting all this time as the little red hen, if you will. We bake the bread, now it's time we're going to share the bread. We're not going to just eat the bread alone. Right. And so what we did was cultivated a lot of collaborative measures with a lot of our partners throughout the community, throughout the city, and around the world. We were able to bring in instructors and teachers from other parts of the world. As a matter of fact, at the top of the year, we're going to be heading out to Ghana on a pre-trip before we take the kids in April. So we're going to go to Ghana, and while we're there, we're going to be launching our science, technology, engineering, arts program that DJ Dorothy Jean, that's my daughter, has kicked off. And so we're really excited about that. And we're just going to take the proper precautions in order to travel. Right. A lot of the young people, this will be their first time traveling and needing a travel visa, because we've taken, even during the pandemic, we got an opportunity to go to Nassau and do a study of marine life. Right. And so like now we're going to be going, doing some quantum physics in Ghana and showing that correlation between the diaspora and quantum physics, something that you don't hear about much at all.
Right.
But Dorothy Jean and her crew are going to like forge forward with that.
You know, I think that's very exciting, because it's not the thing, something that you hear about all the time. And for it to be done in the heart of Bronzeville and our community, I think that's beautiful. Now, I know that you are out and about today, so tell me what you were doing today before.
So today, we're getting prepared for the first installment of what will be many what we call community wash days. So it's like meditation and washing your clothes.
Okay.
So you can come in. We're going to be paying for people from the community to get their loads washed. And then we're going to be, you know, giving them, while they're, you know, washing their clothes, getting them some mental wellness as well from the perspective of basic breathing techniques. I'm going to probably do some one-on-ones with some moms about assessing where their children are academically and how to maximize where they're gonna, where they would like to see their children go. And what a lot of, and this is tied into what we're doing tomorrow, a lot of moms don't think about the perspective of, if you want a Fortune 500 child, you want a blue chip child, you've got to be a blue chip CEO. So that means you have to wake up earlier than everybody else. You've got to make up your bed. You have to put yourself together. You have to have a schedule. And I use this example oftentimes when I'm speaking to different moms on Zooms or in one-on-ones. I'm like, if you ran a Fortune 500 company and someone happened to leave a sandwich in the break room, you're not going to come on the middle of the floor and say, who left that sandwich? And get to yelling and cursing people out because it's protocol of doing things. And that's the same way with being a mom. Everything does not require going to 100.
Right.
You know, so if you have older children, you give them roles and responsibilities. You have children that might be a little younger. Everybody has to have a role to play. And everybody's role has to be the same energy you get on your child when they don't do something right. It has to be the same energy you pour into them when they're doing things according to the protocol of how you run your household.
Yes.
You've got to be able to have family meetings. Mm-hmm. You know, mom, dad, mom, children, all of them. There has to be meetings where everyone is heard. You have to be able to hear them out in order to be able to move things forward, because oftentimes parents, we're working every day, we're working hard every day, and we come in and we don't want to hear what happened and who did what. Now our children are being silenced, and now if they're being wrong and there's an injustice happening in the house, they don't feel like they're being supported there. Now they're acting crazy. Now they're throwing TVs through windows. Who knows where that spirals to? But a lot of what is going on right now starts at home. A lot of the behavior that we're seeing outside of the home is happening because there is a construct that has a breakdown inside of the home. There's a way to deal with everything from mom, I want a nose piercing, to, you know, mom, this is Sarah, she's having my baby, to whatever that is.
Right.
There's a protocol and a way to deal with everything with grace and dignity. And one of the things I tell my daughter all the time, I said, well, I'm kind of like the shepherd here. Mm-hmm. My job is to make sure you don't go over this cliff, but there are places and spaces that she's going to be able to move and have to vibrate in a certain kind of way that I'm not going to be there. So it's important for me to know that whatever the brand is for the Jimelita Tillman household company, that she is carrying the company brand, that she has full buy-in into the culture of our household. And that is what is missing. And this is not an indictment on moms. This is not a judgment on moms and dads. This is the fact that there is no cultural code of conduct within our homes. And then we expect it to happen at schools, or we expect it to happen at the place of worship. We expect it to happen at the skating rink. We expect it everywhere else except for home. So having a cultural code of conduct in a way that we agree and the way that we move forward or how things are going to work and roll, that is going to dictate what kind of productive human that we're putting forth, because, you know, they are living in a very fast-paced age, right? Each generation is faster and faster and faster. And there's a lot of global things happening right now, and things are accessible a lot quicker to them at younger ages. And that's why it's even more important to listen to and to talk to our children and to be able to share stories in a way that traditionally, like someone in my age group, we might have got tired of hearing a mom. But those stories resonated. These things had a reason. For instance, a lot of the services that we're providing right now are things that I've learned over the years just being up under my mom.
Right.
And so what we're doing tomorrow is youth-led, youth-focused. Our Winter Wonderfest was youth-led, youth-focused. Dorothy Jean decided to provide toys for teen moms and dads. We had a lot of single dads. You would really be surprised how many, you might not be because it's very young, but a lot of young men are raising their children with the paternal grandmother, right? So they're taking the responsibility, but they're still in school. But yet, you know, they still want to play basketball and they still want to do these things and all these other moving parts. And so we made a point to target and give an educational toy, a play toy, and a book to the children of these young men and women. And then we got them the science kits and STEAM kits. And then those that were 16 to 24, they were able to get some assessments for jobs because there's a lot of jobs available. There's a lot more jobs available than people realize. And then they're training in various areas, automotive, cybersecurity, and then information technology. And these are jobs that start at $55,000, $65,000 that don't require a high school diploma.
Right.
It's about the certificate and completing the training and being able to walk right on it. Architectural, construction, and engineering programs that have certifications. There's so many different ones. Phlebotomy. And we wanted to make that available to them to be able to see life doesn't have to stop after high school. College might not necessarily be for everybody, but here is something transitional as you are, you were called to be, to create your own race, your own human.
Right.
So now you have to be able to put some numbers on the board and produce to the world.
Let me ask you, and I'll go back a little bit, because something you said resonated with me. I know the Most Honorable Elijah Muhammad taught us that a lazy parents will make a lazy child.
That's right.
You have to invest the time. And I think that because sometimes parents, whatever situation, may be working so hard, the expectations fall to everybody else, the school system, grandparents or whatever. But we see now, we know that the environment is a lot stronger than the will sometimes.
Yeah. Yes.
And so when you talk about that branding, but if they don't own or see themselves as carrying on that branding or that cultural moral conduct, that sometimes in a different environment, you know, they'll lose their way. Don't mean they can't find their way back.
Yeah, yeah.
But I think in this age now, you know, when you and I were younger, I think certain things our parents might have been able to shield us from longer.
Yeah.
Children are exposed to a lot now.
They are.
You
absolutely.
Know? And so in these conversations, it does require us to talk to our children at an accelerated pace as far as the maturity factor, you know, because they're exposed to things. And then you factor in sometimes the parents, and now you have a lot of grandparents raising children. And so in these workshops, do parents readily acknowledge that? Because it has to be some vulnerability in there, you know, in order to make this work.
So here's the thing. We don't do programming with the parent of the teen parent, right? That has to be separate, because has to is a choice of words. We choose to separate that because it's oftentimes difficult for a parent to talk about what they do or don't know, because that connects to feeling like the child's not going to respect them, or you don't know, you only know what that lady knows. Now you got a child might be respecting the trainer or the teacher more than the actual parent. And parents oftentimes don't get a chance to voice what they're feeling. Like, there's a lot of parents that made some choices early on that they have to live with, and that they're living with regret. So being able to first work with these parents to forgive themselves about certain choices that they may have made, it's not necessarily about forgive that man or forgive that woman. First, forgive yourself so that you can be working toward a healing mechanism. It's not about going back to who you used to be. It's taking a step forward from where you are right now. Oftentimes we also, what I've seen a lot of is competition between moms that are in their 30s and 40s and their children that are in their teens. It's a very interesting, weird space right now. It's the Peter Pan syndrome. There are parents that don't want to grow up. It's not even about getting old. It's just about growing up. It's about rushing their child along into a system so that they can get back to their regular schedule programming.
Like, if they feel they missed something, or
they feel like if it wasn't for this child, I'd be this or I'd be that. When you can be, you can set out and do whatever. I've seen men and women go back and get whatever level of degree that they're looking to get, or aspire to whatever position, or even start whatever company that they want to start. All of that's based on will and willpower. Those lazy parents creating a lazy anarchist type child, that happens because of the fact that they haven't worked through things that's within themselves. How does this lazy thing kick in? Where does this all come from? And how do we work toward it? It didn't start overnight. We don't necessarily expect it to change overnight, but you have to open your eyes one day and accept the role that you may have played. I'm not talking about the systemic things. I'm talking about basic household, wash some dishes.
Right.
Basic household, wash some sheets inside the tub and hang them doggone things up.
Right.
You know, your children should not have to step over trash to get into whatever space they have to lay down in, do work in, eat in. House should always be ready. I don't care if it is a one bedroom shotgun shack. House should always be company ready. And oftentimes when people are living in something like that, or squalor, or whatever you want to call it, there's another mental misfiring going on.
Right.
And we have to really deal with what is the fundamental basis of that. And that's why some of those things, you can't have the child and the parent together.
Right.
You're going to have to separate to get to the root of what are they feeling, what's going on, what's happening. And then there's other generational things that have to be worked on also. But primarily, you want to be able to find what's happening, isolate, treat, so that there's no more hemorrhaging out of the brain trust that we have. We got a lot of brilliant, a lot of our young children are so brilliant when they come. And then they're, you know, backhanded about being so smart. Stop being smart. Mm-hmm. And then smart is resonated something bad, right? Yeah. And slick is something good. And, you know, being fast is something good. And so it's these things that we have to work on that have a lot to do with young people that are in our generation that try to have such a disconnect from our parents' generation that we're not giving our children the good things that we did get from them, that we did harness.
You know, and I want to talk, because I know that you probably felt this. When I was growing up, there were expectations, you know. I still got to be a child and do the things I wanted to do. However, there was accountability. As you say, I knew the brand family, right? But I still had fun. Now, I remember other relatives used to be like, oh, don't be so strict. Or, you know, everyone has opinion. Yeah. But there can be discipline and still fun.
Absolutely.
And learning is fun. You know, I know when I was younger, you know, I enjoyed doing well in school, you know, and that confidence became contagious. I still had friends, all walks of life. We still did things. And so there's this perception sometimes that, you know, that learning or discipline, but if there's not discipline or rules or guidelines, then you won't be able to. Self-discipline is necessary. And so just talk about finding that balance or just with that, because you have a daughter, and I'm sure, you know, DJ, there are things she liked to do, but there are certain accountabilities too.
And so when it comes to rules and it's Candyland, right? It's chutes and ladders. It's Scrabble. It's Monopoly. It's chess. There's always going to be somebody that's going to try to cheat you in the game of chess, because they think that they, especially if you're not a well-learned player, right? If you're not great at it, they might say, yeah, that knight can move four pieces up and one piece over just to, you know, knock out your bishop or what have you. And I bring that up because our children do have to know that everything in life is not always going to be fair. You have to always be fair. You know, it's you can't control what someone else is doing. You do the right thing. Universe corrects itself on your behalf. The universe will intercede. God will intercede on your behalf all the time. That no question about it. It may not happen in the time that you would like to see it, but nothing is in the time that we want things. And sometimes you might say, you know what, I want to blah blah blah, and it happens instantaneously. And I tell my daughter, you have to watch those signs when those things happen and pay close attention. You know, God reveals things in the time that God needs you to see things. And I, you know, I'm like, you know, she has a little cousin. I'm like, you can't feed the cousin steak. Baby ain't got no teeth.
Right.
Baby can't digest that. That baby still's on breast milk. It's the same way with things in life. So speaking real words to our children, and even being like the way this generation is now, it can't just be do as I say and not as I do. My family has never been like that. And it can't be, you know, certain things. We do know certain things are family business, right? And we do know that certain things are grown folks' business. In today's time, there's got to be a way that we shift that, because if it's something that a child want to find out, they gonna find out that information. And now it's, are you the person that's concealing the truth from them? Now are you the enemy? Now they believe in the enemy over you. Now they're being led by somebody other than you, because you're not teaching them what's real about how the systemic situations go. You're not teaching them the real about what they're going to be facing out there. And that's what's really important when dealing with rules and protocol of making choices. They need to understand repercussions to choices, because everybody, we have this free will, right? We have the will to do the things that we want to do. But either we're going to crawl before we walk, as my mama say, or you're going to crawl before you die. Yeah. So if you don't submit to the will of what God has for you, you're going to be wanting that water. Like, please, You're going to be drinking sand, hoping to get to some water, trying to find that connection to God. And it should never, like, the reason why, and I tell Dorothy Jean, like, I'm her shepherd. I'm, hey, don't go over that cliff. This is the reason I am here, to make sure you don't go over that cliff. And what I mean by that is, you might bump your head, but you ain't going to have to break your leg. You know what I'm saying? You might, yeah, I'm going to let you get these experiences, but listen to the old sage. Listen to the old wise one. I've been there, done that on certain things. There's not a, so there's not a block that you can walk down a corner I ain't bent. I know, this is the stuff I know.
Yes.
And I didn't necessarily have to have direct experiences per se, but I've seen these characters.
Right.
These are the same characters. This is just Act 3
right.
of Iceman Cometh. Right. You know, if you don't know, so Iceman Cometh is a very, very long production. It's a 4-act show, 4 hours long. Big deal. The most recent person that starred in it was Denzel Washington, and it was rave reviews, all this other stuff. But the thing about it is, you got to stick with it. Each act is something different. You got to watch it. But the characters that come and the characters that go, they all lead you to the closing curtain, final bow. So if someone from Act 1 is telling you something in Act 3, you better pay attention in Act 2. Mm-hmm. Everything's connected.
Yeah.
You know, that aspect of it.
Good. Well, I think we have a caller. Let me go to the
line.
Caller, you're on the air. Go ahead with your question or comment.
Yes, good evening. I'm listening to the conversation, and I agree with a lot what's being said. I am a teacher myself, Dr. Marlo Barnett, running for state representative. But my comment and question is, when you speak about we parents and teachers need to model for the students and be, you know, more of a representative of how they should be acting. But how can you speak to how social media plays into that part? Because a lot of students and a lot of these young kids are on social media and doing TikTok videos and challenges. So can you speak to how social media is influencing, you know, our youth today?
Well, I can absolutely touch on that. A couple things. I believe that the mother's the first teacher.
Mm-hmm.
So we can't run, just like great grandparents couldn't run from the radio or the television or the cable or all the things how technology has, or the internet itself, all the way up to current social media. Images in the media has always been something that our culture and community of Black people have always had to have a conversation with our children about. I don't care how far back it goes. From the minstrel shows to how we portrayed on Broadway to how we portrayed on TV in Blaxploitation to how we're portrayed, right?
Right.
Images in the media, period, be it the quick digital age of TikTok or be it radio golf, August Wilson,
right.
Okay? You're listening to it on the radio and everybody gathered around the radio and we all listening. It's like, close it. That piece. There's all media, period, when it comes to something that is getting into your child's psyche that is not of programming from the way that you want to do it. You have to have these real conversations. A, you have to figure out what is it about it that is drawing their attention. What about it is drawing their attention? Is it the pitch, tone, and timbre? We have to know more about what's going on with these frequencies, with these colors. We have to do our study on the algorithm. We can't speak on things that we don't necessarily know. We have to dig into it. We can say stay off that TikTok. We can say stay off that Instagram. There are all kinds of ways. You can take all their devices, but if you got a smart TV at home or a smart refrigerator, heck, they can get on the internet on the slushy machine. My child's a genius. I've seen it happen. There's a way to get online if you take every single device. So when taking devices away and saying what you can't do is not an option, you have to know stats. Facts, data, quickly. You have got to, all of us, you've got to work 10 times as hard. This is what's interesting. It's almost like what our parents were told. You got to work 10 times harder than a white man.
Right.
You got to work 10 times harder than your child when it comes to knowing everything about any sort of social media that they can have possible access to. You have to understand how something comes up on their explore page. You have to understand how, and talk to them about these things. And then you break down the economics of it. You show them every time you do this, every time you post this, these are the things that they data mine from you. You take it away from the conspiracy factor and you put it in black and white on the facts of TikTok is owned by China. China is trying to gather up all this data on you little Black kids so that they can do this, 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 and this. Therefore, How is that going to benefit you economically? Let's break that down. You want these new sneakers. You want a job. How do you monetize what you're doing? And then you have to look at the fact of sharing the stories with your children about people who aren't able to get certain jobs because of the social media presence early on in their indiscretion of the youth years. The scholarships that they may miss out on. A lot of young athletes are missing out on that. And then when you're dealing with children that are age 9, because that's probably when they're really getting into it nowadays, 9 to 17, you had a whole ring of pedophiles. You look up, you know, you think you're looking at something, a pizza game, it's something else totally going on, totally different. The key to it is being a step ahead, being clear. Don't just speak off the side of your jaw like, oh, get off of that, stop doing those things. Find out, figure out, understand the context under which it's happening. Have these conversations. Now, if it's the TikTok dances, switch it up to something different. Change the, if they're doing a particular dance, teach them the culture from where some of the movements come from. Now you have a reason to put them on the map and show them various things in Angola, you know, in Soweto, in Cape Town, in Ghana. Now, okay, well, let's just, if you're about to do this, let's open it up to the world. This movement ain't nothing new. This movement comes, go back to Soweto tribe of blah, blah, blah. These are the things you have to do. You got to put them on. That's what you have to do. Because yeah. it's not going anywhere. And now if we're talking about social media right now, we're late because it's the NFT world. It's the world of crypto. It's the metaverse.
Yeah.
I saw the Matrix. Special screening of the Matrix. We're in it.
Yeah.
We're in it, and we're in it so real and so deep. And at the end of the day, the nutrition, the conversation, pitch, tone, and timbre, all of that, if we're still worried and wondering about TikTok, it's almost too late. We have to pay attention to what's about to go on with this metaverse. It's real. We need to understand how this NFT, non-fungible currencies or tokens are doing. And we have to really impress upon our children that the one currency that we can always spend but can't get back is time.
Yeah.
And teaching them that value of time and having them understand the obligation of duty with that value of time is important. The seeds that we plant right now, they may not get it all right now. But the subconscious don't miss nothing. That's why certain jokes I don't let my nieces and nephews and my daughter joke about, because the subconscious eats everything as for a right. fact. Certain ways I will not let my daughter speak of herself or definitely of others. Certain things I'm very cautious with her and her friend group with how they move on certain things because the subconscious is trying to get it all in, process it, and figure out, okay, where do we file this? How do we react to this? How do we react to this song? How do we react to this picture? How do we react to this advancement from this man that is somebody's father that's waiting for you to turn 18? Try that one.
Right.
You know, that yeah. thing. That's a whole nother veil.
You know, you touched, when you say the metaverse and everything else, social media, there's just no escape. Like you said, it's old now, basically.
Mm-hmm.
As parents often, we're caught lagging behind.
Yeah.
And our children aren't prepared for that. Mm-hmm. You know, brother says, we're going to take a quick break and we're going to come back on the other side with more interesting conversation. We'll be right back.
It's against your own health that how creates more diseases in your body than you have any dreams of. In fact, the body, stop eating the hog, eat right, eat the proper food, and you will find 75% of your sickness leaving you. Just try it.
You are watching The Muneer Muhammad Show, a production of CRO. Please take time to join us at CRO, the Coalition for the Remembrance of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad. CRO is the National Archive of the Nation of Islam and houses one of the largest collections of historical audio, video, and print documentation on the total black experience. CRO is located at 2435 West 71st Street, the corner of 71st and CRO Lane. We are open 7 days a week, 9 to 5. Our number, 773-925-1600. We look forward to seeing you at CRO.
Knowledge is power. To discover sources of power and knowledge, join us in reading two books from the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, Birth of a Savior and The True History of Jesus. The Birth of a Savior details the birth of this God, his name and his purpose, what he would do and how he would do it. The True History of Jesus, as taught by the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, outlines the true story of Mary, Joseph, and Jesus. These two books and more of the plain truth, as taught by the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, are waiting for you at CRO, the Coalition for the Remembrance of the Honorable Elijah Muhammad, 2435 West 71st Street, open 7 days a week. We encourage you to take the time to visit us and learn more about the Honorable Elijah Muhammad's teachings. We hope to see you soon.
Eat and Run Chicken and Fish has the only chicken you can reheat and eat. It's good as mother's and better than the others. It is the chicken even mothers love. We've been serving the community for over 30 years. We cook with 100% vegetable oil and are open 7 days a week, including holidays. We're located at 87th and Hermitage. Contact us at 773-429-1812 for your takeout order, or let us provide all your catering needs. For the best chicken of your life, it's Eat and Run.
Assalamu alaikum, and we are back continuing our conversation with Jamalita Tillman. This is a live call-in show. If you have a question or comment, you can reach us at 773-434-6625. And with that being said, we're going to go straight to the line. Caller, you're on the air. Go ahead with your question.
Hi, this is Dr. Barnett again. I just have one follow-up question and comment. You That's mentioned the metaverses and the NFTs, and a lot of people don't even know what that is yet, and cryptocurrency. How can people and parents teach their kids about this and they're not learning about it in school? So if you can speak to that.
Is that before, she hangs up? Mm-hmm. I don't want her to hang up. So here's the key. Don't wait for the schools to teach it, because they're not going to teach it as a part of a curriculum. By the time NFTs, crypto, metaverse becomes a part of the curriculum, one, it's got to get regulated first and foremost, and then it's got to be institutionalized in a way that is taught to control, not to master, not to maneuver within. So my thought then again is, get involved, review it, look it up, go deep into it, find out the history of it. You start with the basic etymology of it. NFT, non-fungible, F-U-N-G-I-N-A-B-L-E, token. You have to know what each of these words means, even dealing in the cryptocurrency aspect of it. dealing in basic trading, be it Forex trading, be it NASDAQ, you have to break down, you have to go through all of these things. And it doesn't take
But a lot of the community, I'm sorry to cut you off, a lot of the community do not know this information.
I got it, but it starts with the community I'm speaking of is a community of one household. You ask about parents. And what I'm saying to you is, my thought is, communities and neighborhoods are built together. I'm going to use another one of these random terms, like blockchain. At the end of the day, it all connects together, but it starts with the household. So what has to happen within the household, the research has to happen there. Break out basic coloring pencils, index cards, vocabulary words. Research the information. Make a game of it at home. Learn together. You might not necessarily have the time to learn it and then teach it. Learn together. Learn from the children. Teach the children. But you have to start at home. I cannot stress that enough. It starts at home. It's not about a town hall meeting.
Which a lot of homes are broken. But what I'm saying is
broken home is a matter, that's a mindset. That goes back to what we talked about before we touched on NFTs, before we touched on crypto. What we have to do first and foremost is begin to work on ourselves, right? We have to forgive ourselves, because the whole concept of broken homes is projecting on. That is such a racist systemic concept in itself. Just because there's not a mother and a father in a home does not mean the record player don't work. And what I mean by that is broken may not mean the definition that we see of a traditional historic household, but a household might be a unified unit with the grandfather, the grandmama, the mother. I spoke on single fathers earlier today. I know a lot of young teenage paternal grandmothers that are assisting with raising the children. That home may not look like the traditional home, but it's not necessarily broken. You have to start somewhere. There's got to be somebody somewhere. It could be an auntie, a cousin. Somebody needs to lead and forge this way. And as a teacher, educator, community leader, I say drop your bucket where you are. This is the classic W.E.B. Booker T conversation. You've got to do these things. So if there is something that you're interested in, and there's a group of people of one, if it's a party of one that you're leading, start with that one, teach that one, learn with that one, grow out from there. That's my piece.
So, thank you again, Dr. Barnett, for your call. Appreciate that. We're going to go to the next caller. Caller, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum salam.
Wow, this sister got a lot to say, you know, and I knew that was coming. So I'm just glad to be listening. First of all, I hope your mom, the great Dorothy Tillman, the living legend, is doing fine.
Yes, sir, she is.
Right on. And listening to all that you've said, I am one who believes that the Honorable Elijah Muhammad is right in exactly what he said, that it's at the end of the white man's world. And that that's it. The 6,000-year rule of Satan is over with, and they're just trying to squeeze all they can out of it now, you know, like the bottom of the barrel. So, what you said is great, is wonderful, and it's right and exact and it's true, but this is the end of the white man's world, so I don't expect it to last that much longer. So thank you, sister.
Thank you, sister. You know, and to your point earlier, and I think what sister was saying is that many of the parents may not know or be familiar with this thing, but that's to your point. We have to learn. We have to study. If we hear about it, we have to investigate as parents in order to teach the child. Because I want to have the greater influence.
Yeah.
With someone else, because mm-hmm. no one, by design, no one is going to help the black family.
By the way, absolutely.
You know, so, you know, it's no one's going to come and do this for us. And so it has to start there. And it could be challenging.
Mm-hmm.
It could be challenging between two parents,
mm-hmm.
you know.
Yeah.
So, you know, yeah. all of those things. So no one said it would be easy,
mm-hmm.
you know. And I don't want to, you know, I'm a sound insensitive. I'm not going to quote my dad when it comes to children. But do we have another caller, brother? Okay.
I can go on and on about certain things.
So, right. Because
he put it down, let me tell you.
But you know, as we transition a little bit with that, I want to go back to the Harold Washington Cultural Center. Mm-hmm. And there's an announcement yesterday, again, about masks and other things like mm-hmm. this. So as a center for performing arts, cultural arts, what does that space look like? What has it looked like the past mm-hmm. few years, and what does it look like moving forward?
So interestingly enough, we were able to pivot during the original lockdown pandemic piece and move into a digital space to be able to produce and present with being no audience, a very intimate audience, and cross into the virtual lane. I believe that as a venue owner, because there's not many black owned venues, there might be black managed, there might be black talent performing at the venue, it might be black marketed too, but there are not a lot of black owned venues. Disproportionately, we're not participating in, you know, what these mandates are as it pertains to, well, you can't do this unless you do that, that piece of it. I think that there's a lot of isolation that will happen from our patrons. It may make it difficult for organizations that, you know, who patrons may not traditionally ascribe to what is being mandated to get their gears back rolling. I think that now is the time to be as innovative as possible in our performance spaces so that we have the comfort level for those that want to come to the shows and then the comfort levels who want to maintain their sense of privacy of what their decision is on choices, be it yellow fever, be it anthrax, or be it COVID, okay? Whatever the vaccine looks like, that's someone's choice. And right now, I'm having to really discussing things with our board of directors with what does January 5 look like for the Harold Washington Cultural Center moving forward. Getting a little clarity on exactly what role legally does the city have to do this. How long is this in place? Is this mandatory from here to kingdom come? Is this only under this administration? Like, what does this look like? I feel like since the incoming federal administration that we have, this has been the policy years of fear, the years of fear, and not fitness, right? And not faith and not focus. It's just been fear. It's, don't get on that plane. Don't go across that country. Right. Don't let them in. No. Yeah. It's just been fear mongering. And I call it quick look over there. So what quick look over there is, you watch Animal Planet?
Yes.
Okay. So there was this one time the guy's like, oh, there is the something, something, a rare bear that you don't normally see in his natural habitat. Let's take a look. So he's walking up to go look at the bear, and the bear turned around, and the bear threw something in this bush, and the bush gets to shaking. Right. So it looks like something was coming out the bush. The guy looked and turned around. The bear was on the bear was on him.
Right.
If somebody's trying to get you to look over there, you have to be mindful of what's in plain sight, because there's a lot of legislation that's being passed while this is being presented and promoted. And we have to be very well aware at every level of government what is going on, how it affects all walks of our lives. That might be, what are they forcing on us in the school systems? Mm-hmm. What are they, heck, my child has to learn about certain, if my child was in a traditional school, she would have to learn about certain forms of relationships, but you're not going to teach about menopause? You're not going to teach about the change. My kid got away, she's 50, and all of a sudden be like, what's going on?
Right.
You know, I'm just saying. It's like, but you're not going to talk about endometriosis, or you're not going to talk about fibroids, or you're not going to talk about women's reproductive health, but you want to talk about changing reproductive organs. I am not ascribing to one thing or the other. All I am saying is that there are things that are very pressing to the development of young men and women when it comes to reproductive health that are not being addressed, but there are other things that have been legislated in through the state right now that ain't teaching my kid to say, well, if you have a heavy cycle for 15 days, we might need to go see if it's your thyroid, if you need more iron and that whole thing.
Right.
They're talking vitamin, medicine and not vitamin.
Yeah.
And that's what's happening. So I've got very strong feelings about that.
Yeah, I do too, you know, and man, I wish.
But I want to make sure y'all keep y'all funding.
You're looking at the funding, you know. So
I want to make sure Mandy get invited back to the fundraisers, because them state reps be like Jim Melita.
I'm gonna say this, and it's happened under an administration that black people were so gung ho about.
Yeah.
And you know, right up under our eyes. Yeah. I mean, and we just like,
yeah, they're like, oh, what? Because right. You know what? They focus on, they get caught up in the politics, mm-hmm. and they get caught up in the personality, but they don't get caught up in what's proper, right, yeah. and exact for the future of our communities. That's a problem.
Yeah,
that's a major problem. And our community, as we're putting on our oxygen mask, yeah. we want to be so important. And this is gonna sound weird, so. We want to be the ones to help the little, let me help this person alone. Mm-hmm. What they're doing to that group of people is wrong. You know, I'm going to help you so right. that person can just step up right. over you. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't coalesce over there somewhere.
Everybody has.
I'm in a coalition right here. This is us coalescing. This is us right. coalescing. Right. I don't got to coalesce with any other body.
Yeah.
Because there's a lot of stuff that... I'll put my hand next to your hand. That's a rainbow right yeah. there. That's the only rainbow I need to be coalescing with
right
now.
In Chicago, we've coalesced our way out of every key position. Every key city position has been announced. It's not going to anybody who looks like you and I.
Yeah.
County position. I mean, hey, that's just the way
it's by design. And if you ever, and to speak up about it, it is to... It's almost nailing the coffin for a lot of people. And it's like, if you say, hey, wait a minute, I don't agree with that. Yeah, I might agree with this, but I don't agree with that. Mm-hmm. Like, I'm a Second Amendment person, but that doesn't mean I'm about to be going to no NRA conferences. Right. But it's also mean I'm not about to be sticking you up. I'm not about to be jacking your car. Right. But I do ascribe to understanding, learning what my constitutional rights are in this country mm-hmm. so that if I need to exercise whatever right that is, mm-hmm. I know how to properly present that. And I think that if you gave elected officials a constitution test right now, how many of them would... I mean, that's a challenge right there. I mean, seriously, these are people that are creating referendums and they're creating ordinances and they're shaping laws and they're making all these decisions. But I'm willing to bet, I don't care, it could be an alderman, state rep, state senator, mayor. Period.
It's agenda based.
Yeah.
And it's amazing how many... And I hate to sound like Caucasian people, but freedoms and liberties have been walked back.
Yeah.
Or infringed.
No. But it's true. Because at the end of the day, people that don't... let me calm down. People that don't get it are people who ain't never been outside this country.
Yeah.
If you ain't traveled the world, it's easy to sit back and say certain things here in this country. Well, I challenge you to go to Algeria with that. Go to Armenia with that. Go to... Mm-hmm. I can name a number of countries. And put it this way. When we had to do our visas for Ghana, mm-hmm. questions that they, what's your nationality at birth and what is your current nationality? Mm-hmm. They didn't ask me. They want to, I'm a United States of American person. Mm-hmm. This is my passport. This is a picture of my passport. Mm-hmm. I just think about how many of us that don't even have passports.
Yeah.
So even if we wanted to get up and fly somewhere and go somewhere, where the hell you going?
Yeah.
Because you ain't going to be able to get into the, you want to talk, that's the people I'm talking about that want to be so important. Open the borders. Let them on in. You can't go to nobody country without your passport.
They just want to go to the Dominican.
You dig what I'm saying? You can't even go to the DR. You can't even go to the DR without your passport. They ain't stamping the back of the birth certificate no more. You can't go to Jamaica without a passport.
Yeah.
You can go to Puerto Rico.
Yeah.
Because that's the U.S. territories. But you ain't going to nobody else's country without no passport. And the same thing. And people are like, oh, I don't want to have ID, blah, blah, blah. Okay. Go get caught up in Tokyo without ID.
It's going to be some tough days.
And the thing is, and I hear the brother with the end of the rule, there's a lot of end of things as we know it. I don't think there's going to be an asteroid, personally. You know, I just know that, especially, you got to go see Matrix, man.
But I think when we look at the decline of the dollar, all of these things are just the natural disasters. Yeah. And, I mean, but financially, a couple of these bankrupt. You know the American dollar isn't backed by anything right now.
It's not.
You know?
Not.
And it's going to be tough. I know we only had 2 minutes to go.
What?
So, yeah.
Wait a minute. But I will say this. We're talking about this American dollar that we often talk about a lot in our circles, right? In our intelligence circles. But a game that I play with my daughter mm-hmm. is the currency game. Mm-hmm. You do need to know that your $1 is what wherever it goes. Yeah. What is your $1 worth when we're in Dubai? Mm-hmm. It's, you know, it's 1 to 20 in Dubai right now. Like, our, and if you know what it is, you might not necessarily be so quick to be like, give that dollar. Because when I leave the country and I move with 7,500 or five or whatever I'm moving around with, I need to know that I can get 4 bracelets as opposed to one with my dollar. I'm just saying, I can get a couple Kyrie shells. I just, you know, I know that there are things that we have to deal with within this country that are systemically rooted. There are things we have to deal with.
Yeah. But we have to be international.
Yep, but we gotta be local.
If people want to reach out to you at the Harold Washington Cultural Center.
Okay, 773-373-1900. Tomorrow, please put this up. Tomorrow we have the wash day at 1400 East 47th Street at your neighborhood laundromat. Brother Kurt opened up his doors to us. We're going to be doing washing and wellness. We got some meditation. We got some healthy cookies, juice, and water. And I think fruit and fruit snacks. We're washing your clothes for free. We will be doing it, and I'll also be doing some one-on-ones with some moms and dads about some techniques and things you can do with your children over the winter break. Again, 773-373-1900. Just check out the social media. If you follow Crow on all the social media, it's going to be posted there. We're there tomorrow, 10 to 2.
All right. Thank you so much, sister. Brothers and sisters, thank you so much for viewing. On behalf of Sister Jemalita Tillman, the Crow Television Production Team, I'm your host, Jamil Muhammad. Thank you for viewing. Leaving you with the greetings of peace and prosperity. Assalamu alaikum.